Mr. Mike Johnston, everyone.
Thank you. Hey, everybody. Dude, you practice drums because you dig them, and then you get to go to Scotland to play them. How cool is that? You guys should really practice, and then you can come to my house in Sacramento. You can stay with me and Amber. It's all good. She's cool with that, right? Sweet. So you guys can stay with us. It'll be all good. So I'm going to play for you guys. I want you to really think about this, though. We're not all here because of me, and we're not all here because of Dave, and we're not all here just because, you know, Graham was so cool to host us. Like, that's not the star of this thing. And even if Chris Coleman was here or, you know, any of your idols, that's really not the star. I mean, hello. The star is this. It's the drum set. Because this is the common thing between all of us. This is the reason that any of us could go to dinner right now and get along. And this is the reason that no matter what our political beliefs are, no matter what our religious beliefs are, we can get along because of the commonality in this thing. And I think that's really cool. And then what's even cooler about that is the fact that we are individuals. Because if you listen to the art that can be produced by this drum set on its own, that drum set can't do anything on its own. It's about us. We have to pull the art out of it, and that's what makes it unique. So you never have to be jealous of another drummer because you have the chance to make it as original as you want. So when you see Dave play, you can't possibly be better than Dave, and you can't possibly be worse than Dave. You can just be earlier on your journey on the drums than Dave, or you can be later. If you're earlier than Dave on your journey, then be excited about his drumming because that's your future. If you're past him on your journey, then remember what it was like to be where he is and be like, man, he's going to be great one day because I know where he's at, although he's already great. By the way, let's give it up for Dave because that was incredible. Yeah, dude was killing. When you book these things, old Graham doesn't tell you that he's going to have a warm-up act that can kill it on the drum kit. And then I hear this dude sound check and I'm like, he's opening? That dude's killer. I don't want to go on after that. So Dave was awesome. Also, I didn't book my flights. I didn't come here on my own. I came here because Graham from Drum Central brought me here. So please give it up to Graham and Drum Central. Absolutely amazing. Thank you, brothers. You know, we opened up, we knew we were going to Paris yesterday to do the Le Bag Drum Festival. And we opened it up to Facebook. Hey, I'm coming to Paris. I'm already going to be in Europe. Does anybody want to host a clinic while I'm there? And there were four people that stepped up to the plate, and Graham was one of them. So when you see a shop, a mom and pop shop that's trying to, you know, make it through this crazy switch through recessions and through online ordering and stuff, support them because they're doing it and they don't have to do it. And they're paying the money to get people like me here to play for you guys and hopefully inspire you. So I'm going to play some drums. And like I said, the goal of tonight is to never be defeated, but to be excited. So, you know, when I play some things that you can already play, you can feel a little cocky and be like, I could totally do that. I could totally. But when I play something that you haven't gotten to yet, be excited. Be like, oh, that's in my future. If I keep practicing, I'll get to that point. So it should be a lot of fun tonight. And we'll definitely do some Q&A. You guys are standing. So if at any point the legs are getting a little weak, I don't mind jumping jacks. If you want to do some wind sprints back and forth just to wake yourselves up, I'm fine with that. But we'll definitely take some questions and have some fun. So see you guys in a second.
Thank you.
Well, thanks, guys. That was awfully nice of you. All right, so it's cold here. No, it's not. It's hot as hell. You guys should have warned me. Should have been typing, hey, just so you know, Mike, it's 250 degrees inside the liquid room. Is that where we are? The liquid room? Sweet. All right, so I want to talk about two things today. One, odd time signatures and how to get comfortable in them. And two, drum solos and how to get comfortable in them. Both are things that used to scare the crap out of me. So drum solos, like I just played, are so intimidating because, as we talked about before, here's what the drums will do for you.
Not a get dang thing.
You have to do it all, so it's super intimidating to walk out and be like, what's up? I know you guys all do this, but I'm gonna go ahead and drop the hammer real quick. It's so scary. So I'm still not at the point where I walk out and I'm like, oh yeah, I got this. I'm more like, holy crap, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, what am I gonna play? Start with a right, start with a right. That's a good idea, we'll start with a right. So I had one note planned. Doom, we'll go from there. So we'll talk about that, but like I said, we'll also talk about odd time signatures because for me, I grew up my whole life playing in 4-4. And I was always tricked by the notion that if you could play something in 4-4, you had to transpose it into 7-8 or 9-8. Like, these are paradiddles, but what are paradiddles in 7-8? And I was like, hell, I don't know. I was like, I guess now the 16ths are 30 seconds, and I count them as, oh, I don't know. And it's so silly. It's not that at all. There's drumming. So if I'm playing drums, let's say this is 4-4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Boom, Scotland is dope. Scotland is dope. And then somebody says, yeah, but do that in 5-4. Okay, 2, 3, 4, 5. Scotland is dope. Scotland is dope, dope. Scotland is dope. You just play drums. And it took me a while to figure that out. Like, wait, I don't have to change anything. I just have to keep track of how long I'm playing. If you have this much time to play drums in 4-4, just go a little longer, and then it's 5-4. Go a little shorter, and it's 7-8. It's like somebody in your neighborhood changing where the stop sign is. Well, how the hell do I stop now? Put your foot on the brake earlier. That's how you stop now. That's it. You don't have to relearn how to drive a car. So let's talk about that for a second on the drum set. Here it comes. There we go. So, I saw that happen earlier. All right. So let's say I'm here. A little hint of reverb for the kids. All right. Now this is 4-4, right? 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2. Well, how do I play in 5-8? Well, I count to 5 at the rate of speed of eighth notes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2. It just changes where I start over. And then the thought is like, well, yeah, but how would I solo? How would I improvise? Hit the brakes earlier? Just count. That's what I do. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Switch to 5-8 now. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4. So I practice counting on a pad, you know, paradiddles in 5-8. Play paradiddles and count to 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3. I don't have to change the paradiddle. I have to keep track of where I am. Because what happens is you have this drumming skill in 4-4, and then when you play in 7-8, that drumming skill drops way down because you feel so trapped by this new bubble of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Oh my God, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I hate this part, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Here it comes again. And you know what you do? You overcrash, all of you. I promise, if you're new at odd time signatures, you overcrash, you do this.
Anyways, when you get home, stop doing this. I did it a lot too. And you stare at it like, you go there. And you're gonna be trapped in home base right here. Once you do make that commitment, you're gonna be here, and you're gonna look over. hitting that one.
Oh my goodness. There's nothing more shockingly Caucasian than that. Okay? Not a good thing. You can't play that and then go tell your buddies, yeah, I'm a pocket drummer. No, you're not. You're Caucasian. So what you want to do to have that freedom in 7-8 or 9-8 or 11-8 or 13-16, it doesn't matter. You want to learn how to keep track of time, and you don't have to reestablish the one by hitting the big shiny symbol every time, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, here it comes, 2, 3, 4, 5. You don't have to do that. Just start playing your normal groove. Play this. When you're ready, count to 7, and try to be as free as you can. I mean, what would you do in this if you were playing this in 4-4? You'd probably have a little paprika for the kids. Woo! Now in 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2. I didn't know how that was going to end. 7, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3. Doesn't that sound more free than the first one that goes like... 7, 1, 2, 3, 4. You don't have to do that. Now, I can tell you this. Me telling you this and giving you this knowledge doesn't mean that you're going to go home and be like, fire up the camera. We're doing a YouTube video. Hell no, it's gonna go poorly for you. You have to practice. That's what all this is about. We all have to practice. I'm not natural at this instrument. This is one note at a time for me. Everything I learn is one note at a time, and it's a struggle. And I do the pause in the air thing where you go, you should go down, you should go down, you should go down. Not now. Oh! And, you know, that happens. But that's part of it. That's why I said we're all in this together. There's no leaders in this. This is art. You can't win in art. No one's better than anybody else. We're just at different points in the journey. That's how I've always looked at it, you know? We're all on this drumming timeline, and I just kind of think like, you know, okay, here's my idols way over here, and here's the day I started, and I'm just going along this journey. And sometimes I get a little further, and then it pauses and plateaus for a while, and then my life kind of loosens up, and I have a little more free time, and I make a little more headway on the journey. And then maybe I'm doing a ton of clinics like this, so I actually go backwards a little bit because I don't get any chance to practice. So, but it's all, we're all doing the same thing, so you can't ever be jealous of someone else. So, back to the odd time signature thing. You have different options in odd time. Sometimes you want the odd time to feel super odd, so you're overemphasizing the one because you want to trick people. You want to give them the, like, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4. You dig that? Now where are you? And they're like, oh, God. You know, like when you go to a jazz club and there's new people that are at the jazz club for the first time at a fusion gig, and they're like, yeah, oh, yeah, oh. And then about 3 minutes in, they'd realize the best thing to do is this. Because then you're always on the one. You just don't commit to anything. So that's the goal with this stuff is like, well, what are you trying to get across? Are you trying to make the odd time feel odd? Well, then do it. You know, that's what the singer-songwriter wanted. In the case of the track I'm about to play, it's a ballad. And I can tell you this, when you get sent a ballad in an odd time signature, you make a phone call. Bro, what are you hoping for out of this? And Dave McKay's like, do whatever you want. I'm like, bad answer. I don't know what to do. And he's like, well, just don't make it feel like it's in an odd time signature. So I will attempt my best to do this. There's no soloing in this. I just want to, it's actually just a song that I enjoy. There's nothing cool drum-wise, but it's real, you know? The reality of the situation is that you guys aren't going to go home tomorrow and get a phone call that says, dude, I need you to be at the Liquid Room in 1 hour, and you need to play a 12-minute drum solo. That's not going to happen. If it does, I'll meet you here. But it's probably not going to happen. The reality is like, hey, here's a track. We have to play it in church tomorrow. Here's a track. We're playing it on the gig on Wednesday. And it's a ballad in an odd time signature. And you're like, really? Can't you just like program a drum machine so I don't have to be there for that one? And you know what? In the case of this song, I find the song really beautiful, so I like it a lot. And so I figured I'd play it for you so you could just kind of see the practical application of getting free in your odd times so that there are no odd times. There's just times. How long do you want me to play before we start over? So check it out. Thanks, guys. I know that for the reason you guys come out to drum clinics, that may not be very cool, because I know you guys are here for drum porn, but let's be honest, I know you want like, but that's real. That's what you're gonna have to do, you know, someday. And you don't get a chance to be like, I'm gonna show this ballad who's boss, you know? It's like, sometimes you gotta play some drums. And I think most people that come out to my gigs in my hometown in Sacramento are usually pretty disappointed because they're like, oh, here it comes, here it comes. And like 40 minutes deep, I'm like, there it is, there it is. You want a big ass fill? Here it comes. Wait for it now. You know? And to be honest, I'm not bummed about it. I'm like, oh, you're about to get a quarter note, and you are gonna dig that quarter note. I dig it, it's what it is, you know? And then when I'm at a drum clinic, it's like, all right, I'm gonna blaze. Let's get some licks in, let's get some chops in. You know, let's have some fun on this instrument. And that's what this instrument's supposed to be. You guys are supposed to go home and see this thing and go like, oh, yeah, I dig it. That's why, like, when my students ask, like, should I get a Gretsch? I'm like, I don't know, do you want a Gretsch? I don't know. Well, then I don't know either, man. You know what you should do? You should get the one that looks cool. Because when you get home and your drum set looks cool, you want to play it, you know? It's like, every company makes great drums. Yeah, I like Gretsch. Some people like other companies. Then you should get that. Should I get Meinl? I don't know. You want your cymbals to look like mud? Then yeah, you should get Meinl, man. I dig it. That's my favorite thing. So I love it. The uglier, the better. So, I think that the instrument's supposed to make you happy. And that you should follow drummers that make you happy and that inspire you. And when you watch them play, you're like, that's tangible. I think I could do that. You know, there's going to be drummers out there that make you feel like I should quit, you know. And I just want you guys to know that you shouldn't. You should only play this instrument if you enjoy it, no matter how good or bad you think you are. At the end of the day, the question is, dude, do you enjoy it? If so, yeah, keep playing. Lots of people suck at golf, and they still keep playing it because they enjoy it. My grandpa was 90, and I remember the last time I played with him, he was like 80, and he'd been playing his whole life, and he was still pretty horrible, but he liked it, you know, so it's like, dude, then keep playing, man, have fun, you know, learn things like, and be like, that's so cool, it's like, no, it's not, I licked my finger that's dirty, because I met all of you guys tonight and shook your hands, and then I rubbed it across the head, that's not cool at all, but we kind of dig it, you know, so. All right, now let's talk about drum solos, because drum solos were the most frightening thing in the world. And I know most of you haven't because you live here, but if you've ever seen any of my earlier clinics, I never played solos because I was scared of them. It's a scary thing to come out and just play drum set by itself. So I always played tracks that had room for drum solos in them. Eventually, I was just kind of told, do you guys know who Thomas Lang is? Okay. My Thomas Lang impression is pretty bad, but I'll do my best. It actually sounds just like Benny Greb, but just deal with it. So I had a clinic with Thomas, and he called my hotel room, and I hadn't met him yet, or I think I'd met him, but I didn't know him very well. Hotel room, pick up the phone, Johnston, it's the Lang, beer's in the lobby now. All right. Cool, we'll get some green tea. So I was like, you know, and I'm, keep in mind, there's no separation, besides this silly stage, there's no separation between us, I am you. So I hung up the phone and did what you did. Holy crap, Thomas Lang just called me. This is awesome. Run out to the lobby. We're talking. Thomas is very, very honest. And he goes, you never play drum solos. I'm like, excuse me? Yes, I've watched your clinics. You never play drum solos. Why is this? Like, because I'm not you. I'm scared of them. I don't want to play them. He's like, tomorrow you shall play a drum solo. Do what? No. I need like 6 months to prep for a drum solo. No way. Yes, tomorrow would be good. Okay. So he's so confident, and he's just such a man, you know, that I was like, hell yeah, I'm going to play a drum solo tomorrow. Thomas, let's do that. So I get to the clinic. Thomas Lang's there. Tim Alexander from Primus, one of my early idols, he's there in the crowd. Thomas is about tall guy with the collar. What's your name, sir? Yeah, you. Okay. Thomas Lang's right where you are in the crowd, and he's standing. This will be good. In my head, I'm going, this is going to be horrible. So I think, okay, I'm going to blaze this thing. I'm going in deep. So my first set of notes is a lick that sounds like this. That's in my head. Like, that's how I'm going to start this thing. Now, keep in mind, at this point, I hadn't studied drum solos, so I know nothing. I just know, like, well, go big or go home. First note, my stick catches the rim, flies right at Thomas's head, lands at his feet. I have no extra stick, so I have to ask for it back. Like, and the stick's like, gung, gung, gung. One person after another, I'm like, thanks, bro. So I'm here to teach, and like my voice is cracking. And I'm like, so that was like my, like I was so ready to start doing drum solos without any preparation, and that sent me back like 15 years. I was like sucking my thumb. I had graham crackers and an orange slice. And I was like, I'm going to be here. So I thought, okay, well, how did I learn how to play drums? I practiced. How did I learn how to play jazz? Brazilian music. I practiced and I studied. So why can't I do that with drum solos? I also thought, I'm really lucky in my career that I have friends that are some of the best drum soloists in the world. Why don't I call them? So I got advice from four people. Benny Greb, another guy from Germany named Jost Nickel, that if you don't know, you should check him out. He was Benny's teacher for a long time. Jost Nickel is incredible. He plays for a German band called Yandelay and Disco Number One. But he's an amazing drum soloist. So Benny, Jost Nickel, Will Kennedy, who's the drummer for the Yellow Jackets, fusion group. He's one of my idols. And then a younger guy that I've been doing a lot of tours with lately, named J.P. Bouvet. Those are my four favorite drum soloists. And I'm lucky enough to have a friendship with them. So I called each one of them. And they all gave me different advice. And I think it's very selfish to keep that advice to myself and be like, here's a dope solo. Can't tell you how I did it. Laters. So the plan is to give the advice to you. And hopefully you will do something amazing with that advice. And then one day I can sit here and watch your drum clinic, which I'd be happy to do. So I started off with Jost Nickel. Jost. Any help would be really appreciated. His advice was this: play in your favorite tempo. Seems simple enough, but when you think about it, when you start playing a drum solo, do you really think about the tempo that feels good to you? I didn't. He did. So he said, what he said was, every one of us has a home tempo. We all have a tempo that if I put you in a room all by yourself and said, okay, whenever you're ready, start tapping your foot. We would all tap at different tempos based off the music we grew up listening to and based off of our drumming influences. So if you grew up listening to a lot of punk rock and a lot of fast metal, you're going to tap your foot faster. That's going to feel comfortable to you. Those are going to be in quarter notes. You're going to be like, cool. That's your home tempo. You probably feel good there. If you listen to a lot of ballads, then you're probably more in the, yeah, you know, just hoping that at some point she'll let you slide your hands from the middle of her back down to the rear a little bit, and then she kind of pulls back, and you go, what? Sorry, I was just tired. So this might be your home tempo. I have no idea why I just said that. But this tempo makes me think like that, okay? So let's get out of this tempo. So to my home tempo right here, okay, this is my home tempo. This feels good to me. This is how I would tap my foot if no one was around. And I start thinking in 16ths. Boom, boom, boom. My home tempo. That was Jost Nickel's advice. Benny Greb's advice was play the hits, meaning play the things that you enjoy playing even if other people have heard them before. And because at first I was like, oh my god, every time I play a solo I'm gonna have to make a whole new solo and these things are like 10 minutes long. And he was like, no you don't. Why would you do that? You don't make a new conversation every time you meet somebody new. You know how to say my name is Mike, so say it again. You like that sentence. Sounds about right, Benny. It's pretty spot on, right? I mean, that's Benny Greb, man. He's Yoda. So I was like, yeah, man, that's deep. And so that was Benny's advice, play the hits, you know? And then I thought about that. You're like, yeah, like my favorite band in the world is Genesis. And one time my wife got me tickets to see Genesis when they were on the reunion tour. And my favorite part of the show was their hits, the songs that I grew up listening to that I could air drum with, you know? I remember when In the Air Tonight was coming up, and it was coming up to zhudum, 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 gat, gat. I was like, babe, turn around and look at the entire arena. They're all going to air drum it, and none of these people play drums. How cool is that? He invented a fill that everyone can do on their steering wheel. So I was like super, like that was my favorite part. What was my least favorite part? When they played a brand new song. Shouldn't that be your favorite part? It's, you finally get to hear something new. It's not your favorite part because you can't be on the journey with them. You can't predict it. You don't know where they're going with this new song. So you have to just sit back and be like, impressive. You know, you can't do anything about it. So Benny's advice was play the hits. Next person was Will Kennedy. Will Kennedy is, you really need to check him out. He's one of the greatest drummers in the world. He was there with Dave Weckl, Vinny Colaiuta, and Steve Gadd in that time period of fusion drummers. And he's still playing today, and he's amazing. And so his advice was, give it a pulse. It's got to have a pulse. And when I thought about that, you know, I thought, like, everything I play has a pulse. And then I was like, no, it really doesn't. But it gets a lot better when it does. So listen to some random drumming without a pulse, and listen to how little sense it makes to you. And then as soon as I put a pulse in, it all makes sense. That pulse, even though I'm doing a bunch of hubba dubba. Oh, yeah. Even when I'm doing all that, like you can go, I know where he's at. No, you don't. I don't even know where I'm at. I'm just hitting stuff. But at least you can follow along with it because it's got a pulse. So that was Will's advice. JP Bouvet's advice. If you don't know JP, which I'm sure most of you do, but if you don't, he's a young drummer, and myself, JP Bouvet, and another drummer named Matt Halpern do clinic tours together. Hopefully one day we will come to Scotland for the Common Thread clinic tour. But his advice was what he calls scenes and settings, and I call them environments. And what that means is play in an environment that allows you to explore. Some grooves that you guys can play right now, they're at the top of your skill level, so you can't do anything in them. You can just play them. You know, actually, Dave had a great point about the funky drummer. That was one of those grooves for me. That's a bad groove to solo in for me because when I learned that groove, or say the Rosanna Shuffle by Toto, all I could do was do it. But if you were like, all right, now explore it, I was like, no, I'll be right here all night. I can't even move a bass drum without screwing this thing up. Like, I can only do this one measure pattern, and that is it. And then even if I had to do a crash, I was like, this is not going to go good for me. Okay, so that's not a good groove to solo in because I have no freedom to explore. That's a tiny, tiny London apartment. I can't do anything. I'm just like, where's the toilet? Oh, I'm on it. Sweet. Okay, no room to explore. Now a groove like this for you guys. That's a great drum solo groove because, I mean, if I was here right now, what you're not hearing is the 65,000 ideas that are in my head right now. You hear this, I hear doo doo ka doo, shake it about, let doo ka, let doo ka doo, let doo ka doo, let doo doo. Then I'm thinking like metric modulations. I'm thinking little Chris Dave stutters. But I'm not showing you all that just because I gotta save it. You know, I have this giant net above my drum set of drum ideas, and I have to just pick one out one at a time and make sure that I don't just pull the string and let them all go all over the drum set, you know, and go. You know what I think the crowd wants? No,
No, you don't. You may think you do. But you're in the minority. You're drummers, man. Like, of course we want that. But the real world would be like, did he just fall down a staircase? What just happened? Could you imagine that on an album if you didn't see me? And you were just driving, and somebody went, you'd be like, listening to see if I'm like, Lord, help me. Oh, Lord. Okay, so find grooves that allowed you to explore. A groove that allows me to explore would be this. Appreciate that, guys. I don't need you to go home and be a better drummer immediately. I need you to go home with some inspired concepts where you go, wait a minute, I could play most of that stuff. I just never organized it properly. You know, don't play the coolest thing right away. One of the worst grooves I can play in a drum solo is this. And this groove to me, this is the top of my grooving abilities as far as complicated grooves. This is, I swear, I promise I'm not trying to sell anything. I don't have anything with me to sell, but this is one of the grooves in my new book, Groove Freedom. I wrote the book for me. I figured if I needed it, maybe you did too. So I wrote it for me. So I'm working out of page 86 right now, and it sucks. It's a little biscuit, and the author should go to hell. Because it's really hard. But I wrote it in the back of a car with JP and Matt. We were driving across the country doing the Common Thread Clinic tour. And I would just play something on the back of the headrest, and I'd be like, Matt, what do you think about this? And I'd play, you know, and he's
He's like, yeah, man, that's dope. That's dope. And I'm like, okay. And I write it in on the laptop. And I'd be like, JP, what do you think about this? He's like, yeah, that's tight, man. Okay, that's page 87. So here's the groove I'm working on. Now, this groove, like I said, is impressive. But you have to think, it's a terrible drum solo groove because I can't do anything other than it. Lot of notes. It's note heavy. Now, I want that to be part of my solo a year from now. It's not ready yet. I can't do anything with it. You know how trapped I felt in that thing? The whole time my jaw was over here. I was like, God dang, this is hard. Why are you doing this in Scotland? You haven't slept in a week. So what I'm saying is, like, don't push yourself that far in front of other people when it's like, dude, you're not ready for it. Do it later. It'll come. Play something way simpler that allows you to grow. So, I'm going to do my best to do that in a solo in just a second. But before we do that, I've got a little bit of time for some questions. So if anybody has a question, just put on a fake American accent and be like, hey, when you drive around in your Ford F-150 and a Chevy Silverado pulls up, what do you do? And then I'll be able to understand you just fine. Any questions from anybody? You guys are that badass. So I can just bring you up here right now and you'll just solo and everything will be good. Come on, there's got to be some questions. Okay, well then when we do the autographs, don't be asking questions, because I'll be like, why didn't you ask? If you have a question, everybody else has the same question too.
Actually, I've got a question.
Bring it.
What made you choose to play a basic Ringo kit rather than one of these huge, big thunderstorm, enormous...
Okay, first of all, from now on, I'm calling those kits Big Thunderstorm Kits. That's a great name. There were a couple of those in Paris last night right next to me, and I was like, is this a toy? How do I get one of those? Okay. It's a great question. Why do I play such a simple setup? It's because I'm not a drummer. You guys are drummers. I'm a teacher. I'm an educator. I have to make sure that every single thing I play, you can relate to it and you can say, I have that at home. I could do that. Now, if I had 46 toms, 26 pedals, and a gong, and I played something, I'd be like, well, when you get home, you'd be like, dog, I have one tom. How am I going to play that? So I have to make sure that you guys can see what I'm doing and say, I could do that when I get home. I have one bass drum pedal, a high tom, a low tom, and really two crashes and a ride in hats, and then whatever that does. But that's not necessary. Like, you can make that. Put a small cymbal underneath a big one, and it sounds like this. There you go. So that's the reason. I want to make sure that everything I play is relatable. And usually, I didn't have a choice here because we're not at their store, but usually I ask for the cheapest bass drum pedal they have, because I know that I have a decently fast foot, so I don't want anybody to equate that like, well, if I had a DW9000, no, you'd be just as slow as you are now with less money in your pocket. So I want to make sure that it's like, dude, give me the slowest pedal you have. So the gear has nothing to do with it. The one thing the gear does is it inspires you. It doesn't make you any better. It makes you more excited to play drums, which will keep you on the drum set longer. So I hope that answers your question, man. Anybody else? Any questions about anything? In three? Yeah, brother. Dude, killer question. Yeah, so when you're playing and really going, do you feel like, you know, you get down here on the stick or opposite? It could be either way. Yeah, because if you have a good, nice, relaxed grip, the stick tends to move on you. So I just, for myself and for all my students, we have to do this exercise where you play the basic rock beat, and you shimmy up to the top of the sticks, and then you shimmy back down without stopping. And because usually what happens is as soon as I get down like a little bit, it just takes one shimmy and I'm back. So that's happening when you don't see it, but it's because I practiced it. So you guys ready for some seriously unimpressive drumming? This is not cool by any means, but it's real.
So I just play the basic rock beat, shimmy to the top, which sounds like lame, and then shimmy back down to the bottom. Thank you.
Great question. Kerr, right?
Yeah.
Sweet. Does fitness come into the equation when doing drum solos? I'd have to say yes and no. No as far as what we consider to be fitness, because there's plenty of drummers that are not in great shape physically, that are monster drummers, but what they are in, they're in great drum shape. So there's certain things that you'll notice where you've never felt that pain in your life. Like when you play a lot of bass drum stuff for an hour and that thing in the front of your shin is on fire and you're like, I wouldn't even know how to work that out at the gym. Like, I mean, if you went to the gym and you're like, hey, trainer guy, this, I want a big one of these. He's like, isn't that your shin? You're like, no, the muscle right off to the side of it. That thing, it's called the thing by the thing, that. How do I get a big one of those? It's like, we don't have that machine here, man. So, you know, and then you think about like when I'm working on hand speed on my forearms, well, that's this motion. When in your life have you ever been like, Bobby, how you doing, brah? You've never done that, ever. So there's drum muscles that aren't involved in day-to-day life. So I think you need to be in great drum shape. One of the muscles that kills me on gigs, if I'm doing a fusion gig and I'm in up-tempo, like for like an hour, is my shoulder. Okay, well, yes, I can do like shoulder flies and things like that, but I also want to work on my cardio. So jump rope is an amazing thing to do to be in great drum shape. So yeah, and if you want to build up the muscle in the front here, go to the gym and get like a 35 or 45 pound, what do you guys use for weight? Is it kilograms? Okay, so get a ride cymbal sized weight and just put it on the front of your toe, right on the ground, and then just lift your foot up and lift that weight up like 20 times. This thing will be on fire and it will be awesome for you. So, you know, so you have to be in great drum shape, but not great physical shape. So I think being in good fitness shape is, well, it helps you not die as fast. So it's a good thing. I've always thought of it like this. When my wife's here and I thought, like, how lame would it be if we were out on, you know, walking around Scotland and she fell off a cliff and I caught her, but I wasn't strong enough to get her up. And just to look her in the eyes and be like, babe, I'm so sorry I didn't go to the gym more, but there's nothing I can do. I'm trying my best. That would be bad. So I just walk around and I find things that weigh 100 pounds and I just lift them up and I'm like, cool, we got this. That's the kind of fitness I want to have. All right, anybody else? Yeah, brother. Before you move on to the next. Yeah, man. Yeah, you know, wanting to do too much is so common because there's so much to do. I mean, half the reason that we play this instrument is because you know you can't win. You'll never find the finish line. There will always be more to do. All of my favorite drummers, my real favorites, are well into their 60s and 70s, and they're just now killing it. So this isn't a sport where you peak. You just play this, and every day you get better and better and better. And if you slow down a little bit because you're 64 years old, but you get a lot more groove. So it's an endless thing. As far as learning something and when to move on, my thought is this. Are you ready to record it for the CD that comes with the book? And what that means is, if I asked you, can you be the musical example for the rest of the world of how they should play this, then you can move on. If you're like, no, I can't play that lick on the CD to be the example of how it should be played, then you need more work. Now, the difference is, when I see a lick that I like, I never learn the lick, ever. I try to figure out what is the concept that made that lick possible. So if you heard this. Tell you note for note exactly what that is. It's silly. It's right, left, left, kick. That's my grouping of four. And then right, left, left, kick. That's a group of six. So I went 4, 6, 4, 6, 4, 6, 2. That gives me 32 notes. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2. Hello. Now, that's note for note what it is. But that's not how I would learn it. I would see that as, like, you know, groupings of 30-second notes. Like, oh, I better master fours, you know. To create a lick inspired by what I saw on YouTube. I want to be inspired by things, you know. I don't want to be like, okay, in two more measures, you're going to get some JoJo in your face. You want some JoJo? You're going to get some JoJo. I don't want to do that. You know, I want to just be playing and be like, oh, this is drum and bassy. And then when I'm in the middle of it, like, yeah, I did watch a lot of JoJo Mayer, you know, like, but I don't want to be thinking, here comes the JoJo. It's 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, I'm going to do, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's the JoJo lick right there. You know, I don't want to be thinking of it that literal. I just want it to organically come out of me like language. So yeah, I would watch the video. I'd be inspired by it and try to think, what is the big picture that allowed that lick to be possible? That's what I'm going to practice. And I can practice that for a month rather than practicing a lick for a day. And then maybe somebody else saw that YouTube video. When I play it, they're all, I saw the same video, dude. And you're like, no, you didn't. You're like, yeah, no, I saw that video. Like, at the 3:43 mark, so you know, you don't want that. So, any other questions before we move on? All right. So, oh yeah, go ahead. Sure. Yeah, that's an awesome question, man. How do you figure out what time signature something else is in instead of you just playing in that time signature? It's very simple. A time signature is two numbers, not one number. So when your bass player says, yo, dog, this song's in 5, it's not enough information, man. 5 what? Like, what if I was going 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, you know, I'm in 5-2, but he's in 5-16 going 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. No one's dancing tonight. So, you know, here's how time signatures work for all of you guys that might be slightly confused. They have two numbers, right? Let's say that we're in 5-4. The top number tells you one thing and one thing only, how high to count. That is it. So if the top number is 10, count to 10. If the top number is 20, count to 20. There's no more information in the top number of a time signature, how high to count. So we know that we're going to count to 5. What we don't know is how fast we should count to 5. So if this is my groove, 5-4 means that we're going to count to 5 at the rate of speed of quarter notes. Quarter notes to this groove are boop, 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 boop. It's my best metronome. So I count to 5 at that speed. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay? Now if it was 5-8, I still count to 5 at the rate of speed of eighth notes. Eighth notes to this are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now it sounds a lot different. 5-16, count to 5 at the rate of speed of 16th notes. 16th notes to this are da 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 da. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So when I hear a song, I don't count at all. I do this with my foot. If I can do this in quarter notes, I got to figure out the bottom number first. Is it quarter notes? So let's say that I'm listening to boom, boom. All right, so I'm all messed up. Well, that didn't work. Then I step my foot up to eighth notes. Boom, boom, sweet chicken gumbo, boom, boom. Then I, so once I go, okay, bottom number is 8. Now you just have to find out how many of them there are. Boom, gotten jigga zaka digga baka boom. Count to 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2. Cool, it's in 7, 8. So when I hear a song, like any song that Sting did on the Soul Cages record, I have to go like, yeah, oh no. Okay, the bottom number is 8. And I go, yeah. Yeah, all right, we're still here. And then I go, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Oh, it already passed me up. And then I'm like, why would it be in 5-8 when he named the damn song 7 Days? What are you trying to do, Sting? Freak? And he's like, gotcha. And I'm like, you know, every kid's like, yeah, I love that song in 7 by Sting. And it's like, Sting did that to all y'all on purpose. So, you know, so yeah, I mean, that was tough for me, that, you know. And then Vinny's doing the quarter note thing that... Who plays 5-8 like that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It was like a month at my house just going like. And then like you just go negative, like Vinny sucks. Eh, I don't know if that's really the case. It might be on you. So I've heard that a lot. Oh, Buddy Rich sucks. You sure? You sure he sucked? No, I just can't understand it. Like, it might be on you. All right, so I'm going to play a drum solo for you guys, and hopefully I'll be able to incorporate those four things that J.P. Bouvet, Benny Greb, Yost Nickel, and Will Kennedy helped me with, and then I'll stick around to sign anything you want or to not answer your questions because I gave you the chance to ask them. I'd be happy to talk to you guys about anything. Also, if you're part of the Mike's Lessons family, I never talk about my website in clinics because... You guys should know what it is, and if you want to check it out, check it out. If you don't, no big deal. But if you are part of the Mike's Lessons family, just make sure you tell me that and see me afterwards, and we'll talk about it. All right. I hope hope this goes well. We'll be right back.
Mr. Mike Johnston, everyone. Thank you so much.